just to thank you for being God and God all by yourself. Lord, great is your mercy toward us, Lord. Last night when we laid down, Lord, you allowed us to see a whole new day. Great is your mercy toward us, Lord. Father, we ask that you would bless us right now, Lord, that we might be able to hear from heaven. Lord, I ask that Jerry might decrease, that Jesus might increase. Hide me behind the cross, that all we can see is Jesus. Now, Lord, let the words in my mouth and the meditation of my heart be acceptable in thy sight. You are my strength. You are my redeemer. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. Give glory and honor to our Lord and Savior Jesus Christ. We are just in a total awe of Jesus today. I went to worship with our in our new sanctuary this morning, and as I pull up you can hear singing from the parking lot. So I walk around to the rear of the building and find out that the storm had knocked the power out in their on their block. So they were having church outside. They meet underneath an overhang. And they was singing and shouting as if they was inside the building. Folks was hot, sweating, and they act like they didn't feel the heat. And I said, Lord, you keep on showing me that it's not the building that you worship at.
That
makes you worthy to be praised.
Yeah.
You can praise God when it's hot.
Yes.
You can praise Him when it's cold.
Yes.
And they had such a spirit-filled service that I just said, Lord, I know I'm ready to leave the temple, but you showed me today it's not about the building. I was reminded about the service we had a couple weeks ago over there on off of Central, and Lord knows the atmosphere wasn't conducive to worship. That's why the Bible says that when the presence of God is,
yes,
and if two or three are gathered in my name, I will be in the midst.
Because
you know there's sometimes you might not get to be where you want to be at. Sometimes you're going to have to learn how to praise God where you're at in your circumstance. Sometimes I can't make it to the church. You got to learn to praise Him while you can. I mean, there is a word from the Lord this afternoon found recorded in Matthew chapter number 6. Matthew 6, and I'm going to read verses 1-9. Matthew 6. It reads, Take heed that you do not your righteousness before men to be seen of them, else you have no reward with your Father who is in heaven. When therefore thou doest alms, sound not a trumpet before thee, as the hypocrites do in the synagogues and in the streets, that they may have glory of men. Verily I say unto you, they have received their reward. But when thou hast alms, let not thy left hand know what thy right hand does, that thy alms might be in secret, that thy Father who sees in secret shall reward you openly. And when you pray, you should not be as hypocrites, for they love to stand and pray in the synagogues and in the corners of the streets, that they may be seen of men. Verily I say unto you, they have received their reward. But thou, when thou prayest, enter into thy chamber, and having shut the door, pray to the Father who is in secret, and thy Father who seeth in secret shall compensate thee openly. And in praying use not vain repetitions as the Gentiles do, for they think that they shall be heard for their much speaking. Be not therefore like unto them, for your Father knoweth what things you have need of before you ask him. After this manner pray ye therefore, our Father, which art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Amen. You might be seated in the presence of the Lord. Just for a thought this afternoon, I want to tag this passage of scripture. Jesus, thou art the Father. Jesus, thou art the Father. If you've ever watched the Maury Farmer show, I think 4 out of the 5 episodes that come on television is some woman trying to find out who her baby daddy is. And if you've seen one episode, you've seen them all. I am 110% sure that this fella here is the father of my child. And they'll have pictures of the baby and the man. She wants to start pointing out characteristics of the fella that looks like he has potential to be the father of her child. Never mind the 6 other guys that's already been on the show. But this fella here has got to be the father of my child. She began to say, look at how the nose is shaped. They got the same shaped nose. His lip is curled up at the bottom just like his daddy's lip is. And we'll go down the list of things trying to make this person look like he is the father of the child. And Maury brings out the paper and let him know that he is not the baby's daddy. And she goes running out through the back. The cameraman gets to chasing her. She falls out on the floor, laying in the spirit, wondering who in the world am I going to check next time to see if it is the father of my child. But when you begin to start looking at how Jesus is all of our fathers, there should be a side-by-side comparison between Jesus and us that says, I look like him. I have some characteristics like him. I don't always do the things that he does, but there's some similarities there between me and Jesus. The way they figure out who the baby daddy is they'll take a DNA test. And the DNA test lets people know that the chromosomes that are shared between the mother and the father are passed down to the child. And therefore, this DNA is implanted in the child and is irrefutable evidence that the father of this child is this person based upon his DNA. I've come to find out that there is some DNA characteristics that should be in Christians.
Come on.
That makes it easy evidence to find out if you are truly a child of the Lord. If you're a child of God, you know how to pray. Because it's a consecrated conversation between you and the Father. You can't have a relationship with Jesus and not have a prayer life. You have to have a prayer life. In chapter 6, Jesus is illustrating them how it is that they should pray. It's amazing to me how folks like to pray and use words that you can't even understand. They'll stand and pray for 35 minutes, believing if they pray long enough, Jesus would hear them. If your prayer ain't right, and you ain't right with God,
Jesus ain't heard your prayer no matter how long you've been praying or how fancy a word you used. He says if you're praying that people might pat you on the back, you've already received your reward. We don't do anything that we want outward expression from man. Because what is our church motto, baby sis? Nothing you do for the Lord goes unnoticed. You don't have to wait on somebody to pat you on the back if God is taking record of what you've done. Come on. Says don't just be up there for show. I had a conversation with my daddy yesterday. He said, son, I like that you still come visit Greater Morning Star. But I would like for you to sit up front sometime so folks can see who you are. I said, Dad, I've never started preaching for somebody to see who I am. I don't need to sit on the front row. I don't need to have my name on the program. You don't have to call on me at all. I do it for the glory of the Lord. And if God gets the glory, I don't need no man to pat me on my back. He said, I'm glad you put it that way, son. I'll no longer look for you to walk up there. And I said, Dad, once you receive that, you'll understand that God receives the glory. And if God gets glorified by anything you do, you get credited for what you've done. And who can reward you better than God?
Thank you, Lord.
He said, son, I want them to thank you for the chairs that you donated to the church. Pop, I don't care if nobody knows that Second Ground gave some chairs to that church, because God is blessing us over and over and over again. Better than man can ever be a blessing to us. Jesus says, get your prayer life in order. And don't worry about who's watching what you do. Get your heart fixed when you pray. Don't be like the hypocrites who are just out there praying for show. It says, when you start praying, don't start blowing your own trumpet to let somebody know you about to pray. Nothing used to get my underwear in a bunch more than seeing somebody get up there and want to sing a song before they supposed to pray. We didn't call you to come do a solo. We asked you to come and pray. Why are you up there singing some song that don't nobody know? I ain't talking about nobody. I'm just talking about what I'm talking about. Who you trying to impress? I don't want nobody to be giving me no fancy prayer when I need a breakthrough from heaven. I just want somebody who can get a word to God on my behalf. Right. I don't need you singing. I don't need you beatboxing. I don't need you dancing. I just need you to get a word to the Lord on my behalf.
Come on now.
If you got up there singing and somebody said you sang real good before you prayed, guess what? You got your reward. Says don't let your left hand know what your right hand is doing. It's none of your business. It's none of your business, right hand, what I'm praying for. I'm seeking God for something. It's none of your business what I'm talking to God for.
Yeah.
It's between me and God. And when I start trying to tell somebody what I'm conversating for, it's because I want somebody else to be on my side. Let me tell you something. I don't need you on my side when I'm praying to the Lord. All I need is for Jesus to come see about me. What is the DNA requirements that's going to make me look like Jesus to get my prayer answered? The D is going to have to be dedicated, determined, and devoted.
Come on.
That's my D in my DNA. That's what makes me look like Jesus. I'm dedicated. In other words, won't nothing keep me from doing what God asked me to do. I have focused my attention on my assignment that God has called me to do. And I am determined to see this thing through. I'm devoted to Jesus. It's a sad Christian that gets so easily sidetracked to lose focus upon what God is calling them to do. You have to make up in your mind, I am determined
to go all the way.
Come on. I'm dedicating myself to the cause. I can't be distracted. What happens with the world is the bright lights and the glitter are there to distract us from following after Jesus. We get sidetracked looking at what the world is doing. When we should be focusing our attention on Jesus. Too many Christians look just like the world look.
You can't even tell a Christian from a non-Christian.
They dress like them, talk like them, sing like them, and walk like them. Jesus says, come out from among them. My end is I'm a new creature. I'm no longer the same person that I used to be. I don't do the stuff I used to do. I don't go to places I used to go. I'm a brand new creature. I got a new song and a new step. I don't do those things that I used to do. I'm a nurturer. And it is vital for a Christian to be a nurturer, because you don't know how important your testimony is to get somebody else through their situation. You have to be able to help somebody get past a certain point. Me and Leah was driving yesterday, and she was telling me how she was witnessing to some of her friends. That's a nurture that you have to do. I said, God strategically placed people in your life for you to speak to them. For you to lead them in God to Christ. That's the reason why they're there. When Paul and Silas were singing in that jail, it wasn't because Paul and Silas was bad. It's because God wanted them to save some folks that was locked up. It's a nurture.
Jesus was a nurture. In the A's, I'm able.
I'm about it.
And I'm ambitious.
Is anybody just ambitious to see what God has in store for them? I'm looking forward to some stuff that God has in store for them. I'm eagerly looking for things to change in my situation. We don't need to walk around frowned up. We ought to be anticipating that I'm one day closer to getting out of my situation. I'm almost there.
God is able, and I just have to be about
His business. He understands
that prayer
is important.
The Bible says that we should pray without ceasing.
You should always have a prayerful spirit.
When things ain't going the way you want them to go, you should always just stop right now. This seems like it's a good time for me to start praying.
Jesus tells them that when things don't start quite going the way you want them to, you need to go off in a secret prayer and lock yourself in a room all by yourself. Is it any prayer warriors here that has a own closet that they like to just steal away and just go and talk to Jesus and tell Him all about your troubles, and He'll hear your faint cry and answer you by and by? It's those closet prayers that seem to have the most effect, because when you're crying in the midnight hour,
It's one of them closet prayers that keep you when your mind is wandering off. When things seem to be going astray, I need to be having that quiet time with nobody but me and Jesus.
Yeah.
I found out
that it's important
for you to have that quiet time, just you and the Lord. You see what happens when you start to pray? Prayer unleashes God and makes heaven start to move. Heaven is you flickering your bit to ignite that explosion that is about to happen.
Yeah.
That is what's going to start the fire to going. That's what's going to start God to moving.
Yeah.
Is when you start praying unto God the right way.
Yeah.
He says, just do it. Just steal away. Don't have them vain repetitions meaning saying the same thing that didn't mean nothing the first time you said it. I done heard folks steal other folks' prayer. Like, didn't I just hear that same prayer on TV 2 days ago? Why are you stealing somebody else's prayer? Don't you already have enough to pray for yourself? I don't need to have somebody else's prayer. I got enough on my own plate to pray for. Puts it easy for us. He says when you begin to pray, you need to pray to God the Father and ask that you're coming in the name of the Lord. He points this out to it because oftentimes we pray and we don't even know what we're praying about. So when we pray and we don't have the right words to say, I need to have an intercessor to pray for me. Because I ain't got enough sense to pray for the things that I need to be praying for. My mind is corrupt sometimes, and sometimes I'm praying for something that I shouldn't be praying for. People praying to get somebody else's wife. People praying for somebody else's husband. Don't pray for something that you know God ain't even going to hear you. Pray in the name of Jesus. And if you ain't got enough sense, just let Jesus take your moans and your groans to the Father.
Yeah.
I understand it. And I've got the results. The results are in. Thank you.
Just don't call me Marty.
When it comes to the case between Satan Brown and Jesus, the results are in. And Jesus, you are the Father. You are the true and the living God. You are Christ, our only begotten Son. You are the lily of the valley and the bright and morning star. You are Alpha and Omega, the beginning and the end. You are God and God all by yourself. And I only have one more point to make before I smack the bottom of this papaya juice. Back in 1992,
there was a 400 meter runner by the name of Derek Redman.
He was an Olympic runner sprinter trying out to get an Olympic medal. And Derek Redman in 1988 was in the Olympics, and 10 minutes prior to the race starting, he tore his Achilles warming up and wasn't able to run in the race. He spent 4 years training, trying to make it back to the Olympics. He and his father would get up early in the mornings and go train Sunday after Sunday, week after week, trying for him to make it back to the Olympics.
Yeah.
1992 comes and he makes it to the Olympic finals. Here he is, ready for his heat
track, setting forth to run his 400th race.
He gets off, burning around the corner. And 3/4 of the way around the track, he hears a pop, and he tore the hamstring on his left leg. He falls down in agony, crying about the hamstring while everyone else started running past him on the track. He was in pain and he was crying because he just figured out he wasn't going to win this race. His father, which was on the top row in the Olympic Stadium, saw his son fall to the ground. He seen the agony that his boy was in and started making his way down to the track. He was moving folks out the way because he had to get to where his son was. When he got to the final rail, security tried to keep him from getting over the rail, but he jumped past them and ran to the track. When he got there, his son had stood up and said, "I know I can't win the race, but I'm sure going to finish it." And he started trying to hop down to the finish line. But every time he hopped, his leg would hurt that much more. And he started crying because he wanted to win that race. And then he felt an arm come across his back, and he looks around to see that his daddy had made it down on the track. His daddy puts his arm around him, and the two of them start hopping down the track. Both of them cried, and the crowd was cheering him on, even though he wasn't able to win this race. And when he got to the finish line, his father stepped back and let him get across the finish line all by himself. And then they broke down in a warm embrace. Is there anybody here that knows the race is given to the swift, nor the battle to the strong, but he that endures to the end? What do Christians do when we get setbacks? We keep on pressing. We keep on running. We keep on jumping. And when you pop that hamstring and you can't make it no more, my daddy says, "I see your boy struggling in your own situation, and I refuse to let anything happen to you. I'm going to have to come and see about you." If you look around this study, you will see somebody who had to hop in this church this morning. Somebody's back was hurting, but they hopped in here this Sunday morning. Somebody didn't know how they was going to make ends meet, but they hopped in here anyway. Somebody was dazed and confused, but they came on in here anyway. And when you see that I wasn't making it by myself, God the Father stepped right in and helped me make it over. Look at me.
You don't know what it took for me to get here.
You don't know the hurdles
I had to climb.
You don't know the pain I had to endure. But thank you, Jesus,
for coming off that old top rope. Thank you for walking through the crowd. And thank you for not letting the enemy keep you from getting over that old fence and helping me across that old finish line. We're going to make it one of these old days. I thought about my baby sister had a post one day that said you couldn't walk 10 minutes in my shoes. Let me say that there must have been some times along the way that was hard and wanted you to stop and give on up. But God the Father, in his infinite wisdom, when you was at your weakest point, sat right on in, put his arms around you, and said, "We're going to make this thing together. And when you get to the finish line, I'm just going to step back and let you cross on over by yourself." Thank you, Jesus, for being our Father. Amen. God is good and is worthy to be praised. Jesus, thou art the Father. Amen. You know what you do in the church? In case there's someone here wants to get to know the Lord today, somebody wants to make him your father.